My dear students, today I want to discuss about very important topics, another collagen muscular disorders, which is systemic lupus erythematosus, that is SLE. Now, what do I mean by SLE? SLE defined by it is chronic autoimmune disease characterized by the multi-system inflammation and the presence of circulating autoantibodies directed against cell antigens. What is this? Chronic autoimmune disorder characterized by the multi-system inflammation. That is, all of the body, all the system of the body involved, and there is also the presence of circulating autoantibodies. Organ involvement, all organs involved. Usually, no organ are spared. Most important organ are involved in skin, joints, kidney, blood forming elements, that is blood forming cells, blood vessels, brain, and in short for memorization, JSK, blood brain barrier. JSK means joint musculoskeletal system, S means skin, K means kidney, B means blood elements or blood cells, and B means blood vessels, and B for blood, B for central nervous system or brain. Other organs also involved. The GI tract, eye, lymph node and skull hair. Now, about the etiology. What of etiology is largely unknown. The several factors influence the risk and severity. Among these factors are genetics, hormonal factors, environmental exposure. What a genetic factor, most important factors are congenital deficiency of C1q, C2 and C4, and also there is family history of SLE or other autoimmune disease, which also reflect the genetic relation. And another genetic factors are HLA association. Usually HLA B8, HLA DR2 and HLA DR3. All these things related to the HLA. And another genetic component is considered as non-Mendelian inheritance, occurs in the sporadic pattern, and also concordant incompletes, that is if it is dizygotic twin, incidence is 2 to 5%, and if it is monozygotic twin, incidence in 25 to 60%. And among the environmental factor there is related to the viral infections such as Eastern B virus and ultraviolet light exposure. These factors, modification of DNA, and give rise to systemic lupus erythematosus. Now, epidemiology. Most important is the sex. This is usually occurs in the female person 90%, and there is also male female ratio. It is occurs before puberty 2 to 5:1, and during reproductive years its ratio is increased, that is male-male ratio 9:1, but in postmenopausal period it returns to the pre-pubertal ratio, that is 2:5:1, and age incidence is rare before the 5 years of age, and median age of diagnosis is 11 to 12 years, usually diagnosed in adolescent and more common in adolescent female. Now, pathology, very important. Pathology is, if you do the renal biopsy and skin biopsy, there is characteristic features and we can diagnose easily from biopsy materials. From renal biopsy, there is immune complex deposition as full house deposition of the immunoglobulin and complement, and there is also the various stages of glomerulonephritis, such as maybe focal, maybe diffuse, maybe membranous, maybe mesangial glomerulonephritis. If you do the skin biopsy, and if we take the biopsy from the discoid rash, in this rash we get the hyperkeratosis, follicular plugging and infiltration of the mononuclear cells into the dermal epidermal junction, very important, dermal and epidermal junctions. And if you do the skin biopsy from the photosensitive skin rash, we found the deposition of the immune complexes in the dermal epidermal junction, which is called a lupus brain test, very important and characteristic diagnostic feature. Pathogenesis, in short, the formation of immune complex in circulation, deposition in various organs, local complement activation, and initiation of pro-inflammatory cascade, which leads to tissue injury. In short, now, complication. Most common causes of death in SLE patients are due to infection and complication of glomerulonephritis, that is SLE nephritis, and also due to the neuropsychiatric complications. Now, morbidity or complications, which are in renal, if renal involvement, patient develops hypertension, dialysis and transplantation. If central nervous involvement, patient develops organic brain dysfunction, seizure, psychosis and neurocognitive dysfunction. If cardiovascular involvement, patient develops atherosclerosis, myocardial infection, cardiomyopathy and valvular disease. If immune system are involved, there is both immune system, the cellular and humoral, all system, adaptive system mechanism are involved, give rise to recurrent infection and functional asplenia, and sometimes give rise to malignancy. If musculoskeletal system involvement, there is osteopenia, compression fracture and avascular necrosis. If eye involved, patient develop cataract, glaucoma and retinal detachment and blindness. And among the endocrinopathy, patient develops diabetes mellitus, obesity growth failure, infertility and fetal wastage. Now, how can you diagnose the SLE? There is two criteria to diagnose the SLE. One is the ACR criteria, that is American College of Rheumatology, and another criteria is Slick's criteria. According to revised American College of Rheumatology in 1997, they described 11 criteria for diagnosis of SLE. Presence of 4 of 11 criteria simultaneously or cumulatively over times establish the diagnosis of SLE. Very important. This among the 11 criteria, 4 criteria must be present. This 4 criteria may be present simultaneously or may be present cumulatively over time for diagnosis of the cystic lupus erythematosus. Number 1 criteria is malar rash. Number 2 criteria is discoid rash. Number 3 is photosensitive rash. Number 4 is oral or nasal ulcer. These oral or nasal ulcers are painless ulcers. And arthritis non-erosive, usually 2 or more joints are involved. Polyarticular type, it may involve the both large and small joints. It usually symmetrical but may be asymmetrical. And there is no joint deformity, joint contraction or muscle wasting. It is very important differentiation criteria from the JIA. And number 6 criteria is serositis. Serositis means pleuritis, pericarditis and ascites. And for this presentation, patient may develop pain in the chest, dyspnea, palpitation, and sometimes patient may develop cardiac failure. And if patient develop peritonitis, patient may present with ascites, abdominal pain. And 7 criteria, renal penetration consistent with renal biopsy, persistent proteinuria or renal cast. If patient present with acidic nephritis, in that case you may get the oliguria, hematuria, edema, which may be localized or generalized, and patient may present with ascites. Seizure or psychosis due to CNS involvement, and there is also the hematological manifestations which is characterized by the hemolytic anemia. And if you do the blood picture, in that case we get the leukopenia and less than 4000 per cubic millimeter, and lymphopenia less than 1500 per cubic millimeter, and thrombocytopenia less than 1 lakh per cubic millimeter. And number 10 criteria is the immunological criteria, very important criteria. In that case, if we do the anti-DNA, that is anti-double-stranded DNA or anti-Smith antibody, in that case we get the positive. This is positive anti-double-stranded or anti-Smith antibody. And you also get the false positive rapid plasma resin test and positive lupus anticoagulant test or elevated anti-cardiolipin immunoglobulin G or IgM antibody. And number 11 criteria is positive anti-nuclear antibody test. Then among this 11 criteria, 4 criteria should be present simultaneously or cumulatively. Then some pictures. This is the malar rash. Look at the visage, is covered the nasal bridge, but it spared the nasal labial fold, which is very distinguishing point, and we can differentiate from the dermatomyositis. In dermatomyositis, it is involve the nasal labial fold, and actually it does not involve the nasal labial fold, and it is fixed erythematous rash. But in case dermatomyositis, it is non-fixed. Second fixture shows the vasculitis rash on the toes, and third fixture is shows the oral mucosal ulcer, which is non-tender or painless. And number fourth fixture shows the discoid rash, and it is very important diagnostic criteria. Now another criteria for diagnosis of systemic lupus erythematosus, which is called the SLIC criteria, and recently it is used for diagnosis of systemic lupus erythematosus. This SLIC criteria means Systemic Lupus International Collaborating Clinics. Systemic Lupus International Collaborating Clinics or SLICS criteria. It is established in 2012. There is 10 criteria. Presence of 4 criteria, including at least one clinical and one immunological criteria, establish the diagnosis of SLE. So there is 10 criteria. Among the 10 criteria, 4 criteria should be present, and at least one clinical criteria and one immunological criteria must be present to diagnose the systemic lupus erythematosus. And biopsy proven lupus nephritis with positive ANA or anti-double stranded DNA also satisfied the diagnosis of SLE. Now, this SLIC criteria includes clinical criteria. Among the clinical criteria, there is acute cutaneous lupus, there is malar rash, bullous lupus, toxic epidermal necrolysis, that is 10, maculopapular rash, photosensitive rash, subacute cutaneous lupus. If we compare with ACR criteria, that is ACR criteria, in that case malar rash, maculopapular rash and photosensitive rash, these three rashes present in the ACR criteria, but there is some rash included in SLIC criteria. These are bullous lupus 10 and subacute cutaneous lupus. In chronic cutaneous manifestations, there is classical discoid rash, which is also present in ACR criteria, and another 3 to 4 rash including in SLIC criteria. These are the lupus paniculitis, mucosal lupus, lupus erythematosus tumidus, and Sylvain's lupus, discoid lupus or lichen planus overlap. And these 4 skin rash are newly added in the SLIC criteria. नंबर थ्री ओरल और नेजल अल्सर एंड नॉस्केरिंग एलोपेशिया साइनोवाइटिस टू और मोर जॉइंट्स नंबर सिक्स इज सेरोसाइटिस व्हिच इज एविडेंस बाय प्लूरोसी और पेरिकार्डियल पेन वन और मोर डेज प्लूरल इफ्यूजन और रैप पेरिकार्डियल इफ्यूजन और रैप ईसीजी एविडेंस ऑफ पेरिकार्डाइटिस एंड नंबर सेवन रेनल क्राइटेरिया प्रेजेंस ऑफ रेड सेल कास्ट और यूरिन प्रोटीन क्रिएटिन रेशियो मोर देन रिप्रेजेंटिंग मोर देन 500 मिलीग्राम पर 24 आवर्स अमंग दिस क्राइटेरिया दिस ओरल और नेजल अल्सर व्हिच इज नॉट पेनलेस और नॉन टेंडर अल्सर साइनोवाइटिस सेरोसाइटिस एंड रेनल इन्वॉल्वमेंट इट इज ऑल्सो प्रेजेंट इन द एसीआर क्राइटेरिया Now, number 8 criteria is neurological criteria, which is characterized as seizure, psychosis, mononucleotic multiplex, myelitis, peripheral or cranial neuropathy, or acute convulsional state. Among the neurological criteria, seizures and psychosis included in the ACR criteria. And other criteria are also included in the sleep criteria. Number 9 criteria is hemolytic criteria, which is characterized by the hemolytic anemia, leukopenia, lymphopenia, and thrombocytopenia. This criteria also present in the ACR criteria. Now, immunological criteria, which is number 10 criteria. There is 7 criteria in present in the immunological criteria. Number 1, positive anti-nuclear antibody, that is ANA. Number 2, positive double-stranded DNA antibody, that is anti-dsDNA. Positive anti-Smith antibody, anti-phospholipid antibody, which include positive lupus anticoagulant, false positive test for rapid plasma rigging test, medium to high titer anti-cardiolipin antibody level, which may be IgA, IgG, IgM, or there may be positive anti-beta 2 glycoprotein 1 antibody. Number 6 immunological criteria is low complement. Low CT, C4 and C50 level, CS50 level. Number 7 criteria, positive direct Coombs test. Among these criteria, positive ANA, positive anti-dsDNA, positive anti-Smith antibody, anti-phospholipid antibody positivity, and low complement level, positive direct Coombs test, all are included in the SR criteria, also including the ACR criteria. Now, I want to tell you about the properties of antibody. If you get the anti-dsDNA, which is specific for diagnosis of SLE and which correlate with the disease activity, if anti-DNA is present, you should consider patient may suffer from SLE nephritis. Another antibody is anti-Smith antibody, which is specific for diagnosis of SLE, but it does not correlate with the disease activity. Another antibody is anti-RNP antibody, that is anti-ribonucleic ribonucleoprotein antibody, which is present in Raynaud's phenomenon, interstitial lung disease and pulmonary hypertension. Another two antibody another two antibody which is anti-RO antibody. Some problem in my slideshow. Anti-RO antibody, that is anti-S is an antibody, anti-LA antibody, which is also called a anti-SSB antibody. These two antibody is present in the mother. We think their baby may suffer from neonatal lupus. If these two antibody present, is usually associated with the Sickle syndrome, Sjögren syndrome, increased risk of neonatal lupus, maybe associated with the cutaneous and pulmonary manifestations of SLE, maybe associated with isolated discoid lupus. So, anti-RO antibody, anti-LA antibody, if positive in the mother, we should warn the mothers. If mother carry the baby, this baby may develop neonatal lupus. Anti-phospholipid antibody, including anti-cardiolipin antibody, which is increased risk of venous and arterial thrombosis. Another antibody is anti-histone antibodies. If present, if indicates drug-induced SLE. Now, I want to tell about something neonatal lupus. The neonate present with skin rash like malar rash, which involve the face and include the bridge of the nose but spare the nasolabial fold. It is if baby present at birth with these features, you suspect patient suffering from neonatal lupus until proved otherwise. Now, how neonatal lupus develops? It develops due to passage of maternal hemoglobin G autoantibodies cross the placenta and enter the fetal circulation. Clinically, it present with characteristic annular or macular rash, which is present in the face, usually the periorbital area, and trunk and skull rash present at birth. And patient may present with cytopenia and hepatitis. And most important presentation is heart block, complete heart block, or varieties of type of heart block, which is known as congenital heart block. If you not treated the baby, patient may die. And now, how can you diagnose the neonatal lupus? Investigation, if you do the maternal antibody such as anti-LA or anti-RO, these antibodies are positive. And if you do the anti-RNP, that is anti-ribonucleoprotein antibodies, this may be positive. If you do the ECG, in that case we may get the heart block. How can treat the patients neonatal lupus? If patients suffering from neonatal baby suffering from congenital conduction defect, most important treatment is cardiac spacing and IVIG plus corticosteroid therapy. Now, treatment of SLE. This is the multidisciplinary approach. Most important multidisciplinary approach, counseling, supportive, and symptomatic treatment according to severity, treatment of complication, follow-up, prognosis. These are the treatment outline. Now, what do you mean by multidisciplinary approach? That is, specialist of every side should be present. That is, pediatrician, dermatologist, neurologist, nephrologist, psychologist, cardiologist, rheumatologist, physiotherapist, ophthalmologist, nurse and social worker, all these specialty should be present for treatment of systemic lupus erythematosus, because it is the multi-system disorder. Now, what are the supportive treatment? Supportive treatment means bed rest during acute stages and diet, oil balanced diet and adequate calorie should be taken. Avoid extra salt, because in that case patient develop maybe hypertension, and vitamin D, calcium, folic acid supplementation should be treated, could be given. Vitamin D and calcium should be given to prevent the osteoporosis, and folic acid supplementation should be given to prevent the megaloblastic anemia, and also it folic acid should not be given in hemolytic anemia. In this hemolytic anemia, anemia may be aggravated. And skin care should be used, the sunscreen, and avoid sun exposure or ultraviolet light exposure. If fever, give the paracetamol. If infection, give the antibiotic. If patient develop seizure, you should give the anticonvulsant. Symptomatic treatment for all patients, hydroxychloroquine should be given 5 to 6 mg per kg per day, and it should not be given more than 6 mg per kg per day. During hydroxychloroquine therapy, you should follow up the patient by the sleep examination. Either patient develop scleritis, iritis, or episcleritis, or retinopathy. And for joint involvement, you should give the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug naproxen 15 to 20 mg per kg per day 12 hourly. If not patient improve, add non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug plus hydroxychloroquine, low dose steroid 0.5 to 1 mg per kg per day. Treatment according to severity, we can classify the SLE, mild SLE, moderate SLE, and severe SLE. If mild SLE characterized by the arthralgia or arthritis, rash, alopecia, oral ulcer, and we treat the patient in this group by topical steroid, hydroxychloroquine, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, and low dose oral corticosteroid. In moderate SLE, which is treated by, is characterized by the serositis, that is pleuritis, pericarditis, ascites, and another criteria is nephritis, stage 1 and stage 2, and thrombocytopenia. So, if patient present with serositis, nephritis, and thrombocytopenia, it is categorized by the moderate SLE. In that case, we treat the patient by the IV methylprednisolone 20 to 30 mg per kg per day for 3 to 5 days, oral steroid 1 to 2 mg per kg per day for 1 to 2 years, and maintenance dose taper the steroid and azathioprine, mycophenolate mofetil, and cyclosporine for 2 to 3 years. Now, severe SLE, which is characterized by the nephritis, stage 3, stage 4, stage 5 and 6, CNS manifestations, hemolytic anemia, abdominal vasculitis, cardiac involvement. If these things we categorize it as severe SLE. Treatment of severe SLE by the induction therapy by the IV pitavermectin plus oral steroid plus injection cyclophosphamide monthly for 6 months. If steroid fail, in that case we add the steroid sparing agents methotrexate, MFF, that is mycophenolate mofetil, and leflunomide, and another two monoclonal antibody and added to treatment the SLE. These are the rituximab and belimumab. These two antibodies are recently added. Now treatment of complication, recurrent infections, osteonecrosis, atherosclerosis, MI, heart failure, and pulmonary hemorrhage. If this present, treatment should accordingly. Now follow up. We can follow up the patients by clinically anemia, edema, and also follow up the vitals, urine output, and bedside urine per albumin. And laboratory follow up should include the anti-DS DNA, C3, C4, and serum creatinine, and 24 hours UTP. Now, prognosis. Prognosis is highly variable. It is a lifelong disease, waxing and waning in nature. Spontaneous remission to life-threatening complication, which or may lead to death. So it may be spontaneous remission, it may be lead to life-threatening complication, or it may be lead to death. And with treatment, 5 years survival rate more than 95%, and 10 years survival rate 80 to 90%. Now I want to tell about the some SEQ questions and OSP, which may very important for your examination. Now SEQ. A girl 8 years old girl presented with rash and fever for 2 months. She has been suffering from multiple joint swelling for 8 weeks. What of the DD? What information you should take to reach the diagnosis? Write down the specific investigation to reach the diagnosis. Write down the treatment. So, if we look at the problem, what are the key points? Key points means the age of the patient is 8 years, sex is girl, and SIP complaint is rash and fever for 2 months, and on examination, multiple joint swelling for 8 weeks. So duration of joint swelling 8 weeks. 8 weeks means 2 months, and systemic symptom present 2 months. So what are the DD? First DD, you should include the JIA, juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Second DD is SLE. Third DD is leukemia. Why not remedy fever? Because remedy fever usually duration less than 6 weeks, but here it is 8 weeks. 8 weeks. And what information you should take the reach the diagnosis? Write down the specific investigation to reach the diagnosis. Write down the treatment. What information you should take to reach the diagnosis? Information you should write down information for JIA. Impression SLE, impression leukemia. Write down the specific information to reach the diagnosis. Only specific diagnosis, that is immunological investigation for SLE and specific investigation for JIA and specific investigation for leukemia, that is peripheral blood vein study and bone marrow study. And write down the treatment of specific treatment for GIA, specific treatment for SLE, and specific treatment for leukemia. Another SCQ, 15 years old girl presented with fever, skin rash with multiple joint swelling for 3 months. What is the probable diagnosis? So from above scenario, if you write down the key point, age of the patient is 15 years and sex is girl, sip complaint or presenting complaint, fever, skin rash and multiple joint swelling, duration 3 months. So again, if you think what is the probable diagnosis, and because baby patient is girl, so first probable diagnosis you should consider the SLE. And another 3 component of this problem you should write down from my lecture. That's what other information you should take to reach the diagnosis. Write down the immunological investigation, write down the treatment outline. Now I want to discuss about the OSPI. Look at the picture. Describe your findings. What is your probable diagnosis? Write down the immunological investigation. Write down other 4 criteria other than above 2 criteria. Look at the picture. Is a girl. First one is a girl. And there is erythematous rash which involves the face and also over the nasal bridge and spare the nasolabial fold. What is probable diagnosis? My probable diagnosis is SLE. Write down immunological investigation. Write down other 4 criteria other than above 2 criteria. Other 2 criteria means one is skin rash, another is immunological criteria. And except these 2 criteria, you should write down any other 4 criteria. So my dear students, I think all you easily understand the SLE, and today I want to finish my lecture. Thank you.